Visualize just an enormous bus, like a tour bus with a stage on top. And then outside of that is maybe 50 meters to 80 meters of roped in area. And you pay to be in there and follow your favorite band or group or act.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Abroaders Travel Podcast, your weekly meetup with thousands of entrepreneurs, hustlers, creators, nomads, ninjas, wanderers, and world changers, all seeking to build the skills and connections to live a life without borders. If you want to learn more about what we do or download our entire podcast archive, check out the website, abroaders.com. Happy Wednesday morning, and welcome to another episode of the Abroaders Podcast. I'm Eric, here with AJ, and today we are going to talk about one of our favorite airlines, American Airlines, one of the big legacy carriers. We're going to talk about earning and redeeming points, how to find the best value, and how to avoid fuel surcharges and all those extra fees that make your trip more expensive and take away cash that you could be spending on fun stuff when you get to your destination.
Yeah, absolutely, man. That's the reason that we're both down here right now and enjoyed a nice carnival. It's
yeah.
American. That's how it's amazing redemptions to South America in particular. But how are you feeling? You recovered from carnival yet?
Yeah, I'm feeling pretty recovered. It was definitely a couple of long days of trying to get back on track. Honestly, I said this to Kyle as well, because he came in from Taipei a few days before carnival, stopped in the U.S. and then came down to Brazil. So he really covered some ground. And I honestly felt like, even though I had been in Brazil for quite some time and hadn't really changed time zones, it's only a couple hours ahead of the East Coast in the U.S., I felt jet lagged after carnival because of how much we were staying up all night and sleeping all day. It felt like I had just gotten to Asia.
Yeah, our schedule definitely shifted from, I don't know, staying out till maybe 2 or 3 to staying out till maybe 6 to 8 a.m. But so if everyone out there listening, if you're curious about Carnival Brazil, Rio and Salvador are the two main attractions, both very different. And actually, that's one of the differences about Salvador. It's more of a night carnival. We're in Rio. You'll be waking up at 7:30, almost like an American football tailgate, where you get out there early day drinking, and then the city actually gets fairly quiet by around midnight as far as the carnival stuff goes. People go out and maybe stay out late, but as far as the bulk of carnival, it's in the day, and here it's at night.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I mean, the party definitely carries on in Rio if you want to continue, but they don't have stuff starting quite as late at night. And in Salvador, there's a lot of blocos that just get started, at 8 or 9
or 10.
Yeah,
there's organized parties that are going on still when the sun's coming up.
Yeah, yeah. So definitely pretty interesting. I would say, though, that if you're not prepared to spend a little bit of extra money, know that there's going to be pieces of carnival that you can't access in Salvador.
Mm-hmm.
We saw there's basically two sort of institutions in Salvador that they don't have in Rio. One of them is the Camarote, which is sort of like a VIP area that's usually elevated, so you've got a nice view of the carnival procession
yep.
going by. And then the other one is to be in the bloco itself, which means you're inside the ropes. And that means you've got an exclusive party to follow the
sound. Yeah, visualize just an enormous bus, like a tour bus with a stage on top. And then outside of that is maybe 50 meters to 80 meters of roped in area. And you pay to be in there and follow your favorite band or group or act. And if you don't want to do that, you can hang out with Apipoca on the outside with the people's people and still have a really good time. But if you do want to do the Camarote or the Blocos, it's going to cost you. Being in some of the nicer Camarotes, those... that can run you up to maybe $500 or $600. You get drinks,
one day.
But that's essentially your cover into the club, and it's an open bar. So definitely not cheap if you do that every day.
Yeah, it could definitely run up pretty fast. Other thing to keep in mind, I don't know how often this happens, but they had a lot of rain, and one of these things collapsed this year. Nobody was in it, so nobody got hurt, but... just one of those things you can't maybe quite put as much faith in the Brazilians to double check things. I mean, they were building these things literally one day before carnival. You could still see construction going on. So it's not like they leave themselves a lot of time. They definitely take that sort of Tim Ferriss principle of having exactly as much time as you need to complete a task.
Yeah, that's Brazil, just like the World Cup.
All right, well, let's jump into the American stuff in just a second here. I've got a couple of news and updates items I wanted to share with everybody before we get specific. By the way, guys, we're going to have a lot of links to share for today's episode, and you're going to find show notes at abroaders.com/American. All right, so the first thing I wanted to talk about is a new opportunity for manufactured spending. There's a new service out there called Flint, and it basically is allowing 5 free transactions during the first 30 days. So this is not necessarily a sustainable long-term approach to manufactured spending, but if you're looking at some of the credit card offers out there right now, there's a few of them that have pretty high minimum spends. Maybe we're actually going to mention one in a second that's 5,000 spend for 75,000 points. And that's a big thing to go after. But for a lot of people, $5,000 in spend in 3 months is not easy to achieve.
Yeah.
And so this is
a chance.
If you
want to get heavy on a churn and have multiple cards, being able to extend your spending capability gets you next to a couple cards.
So the way that this works is basically you have... you should kind of space it out because they require that you have 7 days in between transactions and you don't want to go over 750 per transaction. We're going to link to an article that explains a bit further, but the bottom line here is that you can end up manufacturing $3,750 for free and basically put that money back in your bank account. So check that out. That's going to be in the show notes. The next piece of information for you guys is that $75,000 offer. It is targeted, but it's Amex membership rewards, and it's offering 75,000 points after 5,000 spend in 3 months, which is quite a bit better than the offer that we had for 75,000 points after $10,000 spend. We're still working on that $10,000 spend. We would have loved to have gotten this offer. So check and see if you're eligible. The link we're posting has the offer code. It's possible that you can apply online. I was actually able to see the $75 offer when I logged in from my site. And it's also possible to do so over the phone if you use the offer code in the page that we link to. So check that out.
Okay, the next thing we've got is the Chase 60K Inc. Plus offer. So that $95 annual fee is not waived, but you may have some luck if you go into a Chase branch. And that's kind of another thing just to keep in mind. We'll do the best we can to have the best cards on our website and talk about them. But sometimes there's better offers that just aren't public offers at certain branches and at certain airports. I still know that my uncle got a United card for a bigger bonus than there's anywhere online in the Boston airport. So just keep your eyes peeled.
The key thing is to really do your homework, though, because much more often than not, in my experience, the offers are worse. So a lot of times, you know, they're taking advantage of putting somebody out there. You know, if you think about the guy in the airport, they're probably getting some sort of a commission, so it's raising the bank's costs a little bit. I've seen a lot of times Delta offering 30,000 points when they're offering 50,000 online and stuff. So be careful, you know, double check, but certainly be on the lookout for those types of offers. And the other thing, so this offer is usually 50,000 points. And just to put that in perspective, typically the annual fee is waived for the first year. So you're getting an extra 10,000 points for $95. So that comes out to less than one penny per point. And it's a really good deal to pay the extra money and get that extra 10,000 points.
Yeah, absolutely. The final piece of news before we get into the AA stuff is United Saver discount is going away on February 28th. So all it really is they've got some select routes that they're giving discounts on from the Saver prices. None of them are dramatic, but there are some 10,000 point savings. So let me look it up here really quick. Actually, from Europe to the U.S. in business class, that's one of the bigger savers. You save 12,500 miles. So instead of 70,000, it's 57,500. Also got a couple routes to Asia, but we'll link to that in the show notes. But the key is that deal is going away on February 28th. So if you book before February 28th, you can book travel all the way up to December 31st of this year. And we'll link to that screenshot that's got all the different routes. It's not huge, but if you are heavy on United miles and you're going to be traveling, give it a look.
Yeah, the thing is basically if you book on United, you're already paying the lower price. So that should stay the same. But this gives you the ability to book on their partner airlines, which gives you a ton more route flexibility and, frankly, a lot better airlines because in business class, United is not impressive in any sense. All right, so let's jump into American Airlines. We're going to spend most of our time talking about redeeming. I think you guys have heard a lot from us on the credit card front, but I did want to go over a couple of important offers that you should be aware of, and these will give you a chance to stock up at least 150,000 points with American Airlines, which makes it a lot easier to take advantage of some of these great redemption opportunities we're going to talk about today. So the first one is the Citi Platinum Select cards. There's a business version and a personal version. Both of those are offering 50,000 points after $3,000 spend in 90 days. Note that the personal version as of just a few days ago was at $2,000 spend. Mm-hmm. So that spend did go up. You're now looking at $3,000, but still a really good deal. And one other thing that you guys want to know about the personal version of this is it offers a 10% rebate on redeemed miles. So if you redeem 100,000 miles in a year, you're going to get 10,000 miles back. And this year we've almost already covered that whole mm-hmm. ground and gotten our full 10,000 mile rebate. So always, and we'll talk about it a little bit further in the redeeming section, but if you're buying an award ticket with American Airlines, you always want to use that City Platinum Select card because that's going to give you the 10% rebate. And the key thing is it needs to be the card in your name and it needs to be the card that earns points for your American Airlines account, the one that you're redeeming the miles from. So in other words, if AJ wanted to redeem miles from his American Airlines account, I can't use my Citi card to pay for the taxes and fees and get a 10% rebate. It's only if AJ uses his own card. So keep that in mind. It's a little bit different, but it does work for buying for friends. So if I'm using my miles for AJ and I'm using my credit card to pay the taxes and fees, I still get that 10% rebate. So keep that one in mind. The last card that we wanted to cover here with American is the Barclays card. It's actually not an American Airlines card yet, but it will be converted, and that's happening pretty soon. So this is really getting on to your last chance to get that 50,000 US Airways miles offer, and those miles will convert directly into American miles when the merger completes sometime in the second quarter of this year. So if you haven't gotten that card, there's absolutely no reason not to jump on it now.
Yeah, there's one more card. It's not the most attractive, but it does have an extended minimum spend. Is the Amex Star Preferred Guest Point. You can transfer those points into American Airlines, and right now that's $5,000. That's double the runway. 180 days, no?
Yep. Yeah, so, 6 months.
So there's that as well. But 25,000 points, definitely better off focusing your credit card efforts on those other points.
The one thing to keep in mind is that those 25,000 points will actually convert into 30,000 points. Because you get a 10,000 or you get a 5,000 point bonus when you redeem 20,000 points together. So keep in mind that those Starwood Preferred Guests actually transfer at a 1 to 1.25 ratio, but you have to transfer in chunks of 20 grand. So something to keep in mind, and also know that that card does typically offer 30,000 points once a year, roughly.
Yeah.
And so you just got to kind of wait for that to come around, but not a bad option if you want to stock up on some American miles.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's get into the redeeming. That's kind of the more useful stuff. So.
Yeah. One more thing. I guess we hardly ever talk about this, but you also can earn American Airlines miles from Oneworld flights.
Yes. Good point.
And
very
flying
point.
American. That was the original idea behind frequent flyer miles. So keep this in mind. I guess the main point here is that it's really easy to just get lazy when you book a flight if you're flying like TAM. We're going to be flying TAM probably down to Rio and Sao Paulo in the mm-hmm. next couple of months. Or LAN or Cathay Pacific within Asia, it's really easy to just forget to put a frequent flyer number on that reservation, and you can earn American Airlines miles with all of the Oneworld carriers. Mm-hmm. And that would be my recommendation. There aren't any other Oneworld programs that are really worth accruing miles right now, so I would book all of my Oneworld flights with my American Airlines frequent flyer number on the reservation and earn those extra miles to help you get these redemptions we're going to talk about.
Yeah, and you can check in the show notes for the program page for American Airlines and all of their partners and everyone else that's in Oneworld that can help you earn AA miles from booking for them. So now getting into redeeming. So American, the award pricing is a zone-based chart. They've got Saver and multiple levels of standard awards. That's Savers are pretty much the good ones that you want. You really want to stay away from the standard level awards. And also they've got reduced price of awards, which is essentially like off-peak times. They use different language all over their website and the Oneworld stuff, but you can definitely get some really good deals for those reduced price. For an example for you guys, is Eric and I came down to Salvador on what would be considered the Saver, and that was $30,000, but the off-peak goes all the way down to $20,000 a time, which is a massive deal.
Yeah, that's a really big win. I mean, so if you think about a round trip, it would typically be $60,000. And if you manage to get your round trip during the off-peak times, you're going to be able to get it for $40,000. So that's a really significant savings. And actually, I'm going to be flying back to Dallas for the Frequent Traveler University event. Mm-hmm. And that is going to happen in April, and that is during the $20,000 sale. So I'll be getting that round trip for a total of $40,000.
All right, how about those mileage rebates, kind of what we talked about earlier with the Citi card?
Yeah, so you can just pay the taxes and fees. Again, I just want to make sure it's clear because you can spend a lot of money on airfare And the taxes and fees can be as low as $5.60.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And when it's that little, you tend not to think about which credit card to use, because $5.60 is only going to be 5 points. It doesn't really matter which card you earn. But in this particular case, you're going to get priority boarding, you're going to get free checked bags, and you're also going to get 10% of your miles back. So if you're booking a 50,000 point award from, say, the U.S. to South American business class, that's only going to cost you 45,000 American Airlines miles. Those extra 5,000 really do make a difference. So make sure to use your City Platinum Select card when you're booking those tickets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so now we're going to get into some featured redemptions, just to kind of paint a picture for you guys of what's possible. But I think it's good to start off by what would be an example of doing it wrong. So, for example, if you want to go from Detroit to Chicago and you use your American Airlines miles, you are doing it wrong, because that'll be 12,500 miles. And just to paint a picture, Detroit to Lima, Peru, that's 15,000 on the off-peak and most likely 17,500 points. So getting into the actual featured redemptions, one of the most attractive ones in all of the frequent flyer world is you can go from the continental U.S. to Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, or Venezuela in business class for 30,000 in the off-peak. 40,000 in first, but Eric and I were talking earlier, and the three-class cabins heading to those countries are probably not all that many, so that'd probably be pretty tough to find in first class. But then again, those the same regions, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, and Venezuela, as low as 15,000 in economy.
Yeah, and one resource you guys can use to get a look at what type of business class, because frankly, if you're going to Central or Northern South America from the U.S., depending on your route, you may be looking at a domestic plane operating that international route. And so a great resource is seatguru.com. That's going to let you look up the flight number. You just basically plug in the airline, the location that you're traveling from and to, and the date of travel, and it's going to give you the actual plane that operates that route or that's scheduled to, and it'll show you what kind of seats are on that plane, what kind of configurations, whether you lay flat, whether you're going to be in one of those crappy old recliner seats.
Yeah, sometimes it's just not worth it. That was actually the first trip we ever took with Miles. Our leg from Miami to Detroit was in business class, so we got to drink, but it was so underwhelming, man. It's like economy comfort, you know?
Yep, yeah, exactly.
Moving on into the other featured redemption, staying in South America, still really attractive when you think about how few miles it is and how much money it would be to buy the flight, is the rest of South America. So Argentina, Bolivia, Brazil, Chile, Paraguay, Uruguay, 30,000 points at a saver, and that off-peak we talked about down to 20,000 points. So, I mean, going from the northern United States to Buenos Aires is a pretty expensive flight. If you go kayak that right now, it's probably anywhere from 14 to 1800 bucks, and for 20,000 miles, and what would end up being anywhere from $6 to maybe $35 in taxes and fees, that is that's pretty huge. And then the next ones, the final redemptions that are really solid, are Japan and Korea. So as low as 25,000 on the off peak, that's enormous savings. Normally the level is at 32,500, and then you've got business class as low as 50K. And I realize I just missed one. So Eric, you want to cover the final?
It's just a different part of Asia. The Japan and Korea is a separate zone in Asia. And Asia too, which I believe covers Hong Kong and China and probably a few other destinations, those are just relatively a lot better than the competitors. So if you look at other airlines like United and Delta, you're going to see a much better price in business class. American charges $55,000 one way for Sabre and $67,500 for first class. The first class one's a big difference because we book a lot of trips to Asia for folks with the booking service, and almost all the time you're seeing $75,000 just for business class.
Yeah.
So getting a first class seat for $67,500, that's a really good deal and definitely something to look into.
And the hard product is just nicer planes making that route. You're much more likely to find a really nice business class product going to Tokyo than going to Lima, Peru.
Yeah, well, and also, I mean, think about the flight time. You know, my flight from Chicago to Hong Kong was almost 17 hours.
Yeah.
That is getting your money's worth in first class. You know, you don't want to spend all your miles getting in first class on a 7-hour flight from Miami to Lima, Peru. You want to spend that time 16 hours sleeping 7 or 8 of them and just drinking to your heart's content in a long-haul business or first-class flight. So keep that in mind when you're trying to decide how to spend your miles as well. All right, so we've got a couple more minutes here, and we want to cover a few of the fees and different rules that you're going to encounter when you're booking flights with your American Airlines miles. So the first thing is that once you've confirmed your flight, you're going to have to spend $150 to change the origin or destination on your ticket. And there is one really interesting exception here, and that is that if you upgrade to a higher class of service within the same region, they don't apply that fee. So in other words, one of the things I wanted to do on this flight to Dallas, I was hoping to actually make a small change and fly back on a later date, and that was going to incur a change fee. But it is possible to upgrade your ticket. And so maybe if I decided to upgrade and fly business class instead of economy, I could save that $150 change.
It'd pretty much be, depending on what your balances are, I mean, $20K to save $150, it's not the most ideal thing, but if you just want to save cash, definitely.
Yeah, and obviously get a much better experience in that case as well. There are also some weird cases where you might save miles and save money and avoid the fee. And that would be like if I had really had to get to this conference and failed to book it early enough, maybe I paid for an economy anytime award at 75,000 points. It's possible to upgrade to a 50,000 point business saver award. You've got business class instead of economy, you're saving 25,000 miles, and you're not paying that change.
Yeah, that's definitely something to keep in mind. Kind of funny they allow that to happen, but I guess they have enough rules it is to keep track of. So the next fee that you can run into is a closing booking fee. So if you want to use your miles to book travel within 21 days of departure, you are going to have to pay $75. There's really no way around that. There's a couple other fees too. There's phone fees, and we're still not positive exactly how this works in practice. In theory, according to their website, if you book over the phone, there's a $30 fee for a domestic flight and a $40 fee for an international flight. But they also claim that if you cannot book through AA.com, then the fee will get waived. So,
and by the way, the agents don't know anything about what the rule actually means, because I've had people tell me totally different things. I always start with that principle that whatever ticket I'm looking at simply can't be booked through the website. Sometimes it's true, sometimes it's a complete lie, and I just want help because I can't get something to work the way I want, or I can't find the exact route I want. But they will waive that fee. One thing you know is that sometimes they're going to actually transfer you to web support, and you'll have to explain your problem to the web advisors. And then once they verify that it's screwed up on the website, they'll put in a phone waiver and transfer you back to the booking agent. Depends on how much time you're really willing to put in to save a $30 to $40 fee. But I will tell you that if you call back enough times, I very rarely had a case where I couldn't get that fee waived eventually.
Yeah, but you can see just how important it is to play your cards right if you've got enough time. I mean, if you have a change fee, a closing booking fee, and an international phone booking fee, that takes you to $265 right there on just not, you know, the stuff that you really shouldn't have to pay if you plan correctly. So.
Yeah, and that's a great point to make. The other thing you should know is that it's really convenient to book these awards on the American Airlines mm-hmm. website. So there's a few partners that aren't on the website. Namely, you're not going to find Japan Airlines, and you're not going to find Cathay Pacific bookable through the American Airlines website. There are others, but you can actually see that on the Abroaders program page. You're going to see which airlines are bookable. But for the major partners, you're going to find most of them bookable through the American Airlines site. And whenever possible, I advise doing it that way, because it just makes changes easier and it makes it cheaper for you. Mm-hmm. You don't have to worry about spending a bunch of time on hold.
Yeah, definitely. Well, before we get into the merger with US Airways, let's talk a couple of routing rules and different rules. So first of all, one thing that you should know by now, because of the way we've given examples, is one-ways are possible, and that's kind of just becoming more prevalent, that you can book one-way travel for half of what a round trip should cost and vice versa. There are no stopovers allowed, but there are open jaws allowed. And for those of you that don't know an open jaws, an example that I did this past year is I went from Detroit to Bangkok, and I flew home from Saigon. So I was responsible for getting from Bangkok to Saigon, but I knew I could buy a really cheap ticket. So flying into one place and flying out of another place, there are some limitations to that, but if you're within the same region, I think, then it's
well, actually, in American terms, it doesn't matter at all, because you can book one ways, you can do a double open jaw and have no relation in terms of the region.
Right.
So you're actually, you know, the open jaw is just a nice framework to think about how you're going to plan your travel. So, mm-hmm. you know, thinking about the advantage of possibly being able to fly back from another city, it's way cheaper to get a one-way flight in a lot of cases in terms of paid tickets. So if you want to fly into Bangkok and fly home from Ho Chi Minh, it can be a lot cheaper if you have that use that open jaw feature, because you fly into Bangkok and all you have to do is get a one-way to Ho Chi Minh and you're already in the right city for your trip home. If you didn't have that open jaw on the award ticket, then you'd have to fly all the way to Ho Chi Minh and then all the way back. It's like extra time flying, it's wasted money. So that can be a really good rule, and you want to plan your trips accordingly. So the last thing we wanted to cover is a little bit of information that we've got on the Abroaders resource for American Airlines. And you might be wondering sort of why we've got information about what their hubs are. And it can be really important when you're trying to figure out how to get your overseas segment. So we've talked about in other episodes that you want to start with the big overwater segment when you're searching for award availability, especially for business and first class. And so we've got the hubs listed. American's hubs are Dallas-Fort Worth, John F. Kennedy, Chicago, O'Hare, and Miami. And so those are the major airports that you're going to see the most American Airlines flights coming out of. And so that's really a good place to start. If you're looking for routes to Asia or from wherever, it's really helpful to think about how you could position to one of those airports to be able to fly onward. And then the same thing, Miami is by far the biggest hub getting to South America. There's a ton of daily flights into Latin and Central America. So you want to use those hubs as sort of a reference point. Obviously, American does have international flights out of lots of cities in the U.S., but those are the core places that you can start your search and potentially save yourself quite a bit of time.
Yeah, that's a really good point on the positioning. Final thing we'd touch on is the merger with U.S. Airways. So American and U.S. Airways are becoming one, and that's kind of, we joke around about the U.S. Airways credit card right now. It seems like almost everyone's getting approved for it because they're just trying to make hay while they can.
And they're sprinting full speed at new customer acquisition. It is a really good card. It's going to be a great deal for those people that do get in under the wire and pick it up. But just to sort of give you guys a framework, we think, and a lot of the other bloggers in the space think, that probably mid-May is a good date to sort of estimate the full integration of frequent flyer programs. Now, we don't even know exactly what that means in terms of what you're able to do, but it's likely that your points balance from U.S. Airways is going to combine with your American balance sometime in the middle of the second quarter, so probably mid to late May. It always takes longer than they think it's going to. But the real question that you want to ask yourself with respect to this is, does it make sense to use your U.S. Airways miles now, or should you wait until they combine with your American Airlines balance? And the real rule of thumb here is that you got to know that if you've got enough U.S. Airways miles to do a round trip, mm-hmm. and you actually intend to do a round trip, you don't want to just be like us and just hang out in Brazil indefinitely, then you should probably consider using the U.S. Airways, because their routing rules are great, because they do have those stopovers. So you can stop in Europe on the way to Asia. You can actually book a round-the-world trip for essentially round-trip pricing. And they've got cheaper prices even than American and into a lot of regions of the world. So you've probably got a couple of months, best case scenario three, to mm-hmm. get those tickets booked if you want to use the U.S. Airways rules. Otherwise, sit tight and you're going to be able to use your U.S. Airways miles, combine them with that American AAdvantage, and use the information you got today in the podcast, which you can find all the links at abroaders.com/American.
This week's International Jam is brought to you by a South African who went to school in England and then moved to New York to launch his career. He goes by St. Lucia, and this week's track is All Eyes on You. Happy travels.
I will never take back words that I said, that I will always come back to you. And even in the meantime, I will always stand by the mirror on the shelf. Call you in the nighttime, call you in the daytime, canvas up to you.
Hey, Abroaders, don't be shy. Hop over to the website and join our email list for exclusive travel hacking content. If you like what we're up to, the best way you can support the show is by leaving us a 5-star review on iTunes. Lastly, we would love to hear from you, so send your show feedback to Eric or AJ at Abroaders.com. We will see you next week.